Well, here we are at Everglades Airboat Expeditions. Obviously, we're in the Everglades, and we're getting ready to go on a private tour. We're supposed to be out there on the Everglades for about an hour and a half-ish. So I think that's our, no, that's not our boat. Our airboat, I think, is this brown one here, or tan one. Yeah, it looks like the six-seater, seven-seater, but it's just the two of us. We booked a private tour. This is the Everglades and Francis S. Taylor Wildlife Management Area. Okay. So, let's go ahead and get on the boat, and we'll catch up with you later.
A few moments later.
Chug, chug, chug.
Florida Everglades. Also known as the River of Grass. Any idea why they nicknamed it that?
All the grass?
Because there's a lot of grass.
And it's all a lot of water for...
Now, who's ready to start the walking portion on tour?
Nope. Nope.
Truth be told, if we wanted to walk, we could, because everything we just drove over is only about 1.5 to 2 feet deep.
Really?
Now, it is all mud and muck, so we would sink into it a little bit, but definitely walk. Now, take a look around us. Everything we just drove over, what does it look like? A swamp or a river?
Kind of like a swamp.
I agree. It does look like a swamp. Does it smell like one?
No.
It does not. That's because this is the widest and the slowest river in the world. And we estimate that at its widest portion, it's going to be about 50 miles wide, about 150 miles long, but the water only moves at anywhere between 50 feet to 1.5 miles a day. This is why it looks like a swamp and even acts like one, but we get the benefits of it not smelling like
it. Because it's moving.
Now the river does originate from Lake Okeechobee, which is in the center of Florida, and Okeechobee does have several rivers and springs that feed into it. And yeah, it's that rainy season. It overflows, works its way down to us, and then eventually out into the bay and the Keys. Now down there in the bay, we're going to have what's called brackish water. This is where the fresh and the salt meet. At that point, we have something that does not exist anywhere else on the planet. All three of the crocodilian species coexisting. So we are going to have the American alligator, the American crocodile, and as of about 50 years, the Cuban caiman. Even the caimans are trying to leave Cuba. Nah, caimans and crocs are pretty much the same thing. Caimans are just miniature versions of the crocs. Both of these guys prefer to be out in our salt water, while our alligators prefer to be here in the fresh water with us. Do you guys happen to know any difference between alligators and crocs?
Their snouts.
The snout, do you know who's who?
The long one is the croc.
Not necessarily.
No.
Shape.
The shape.
Oh, okay.
The shape of it. If it's a cone shape, it's the croc. If it's the round shape, it's the alligator.
Correct. So kind of the crocodile's going to have the narrow, pointy snout, so kind of a V shape.
Yeah, yeah.
While an alligator's going to have the U shape, the round, right? It's going to be wider, rounder, more of a U shape snout. Okay. Teeth. Crocs are known for having a significant overbite, so when they close their mouths, you can see pretty much all of their teeth. It's a little intimidating. Alligators, on the other hand, they're from Miami. They're bougie. They get dental. Most of their teeth are in their mouths. Alligators are black, crocodiles are brown, and of course we can't forget the most important difference of all. One says see you later and the other one after a while. Now another significant difference is going to be aggression levels. See, alligators get a really bad name from their brother, the crocs. Crocs are the ones that are known for being quite aggressive, while alligators, on the other hand, they're actually quite docile. As long as you maintain a respectful distance and leave them alone, they will leave you alone. Now, if you mess with them, you will find out very quickly how aggressive they can be. And there are exceptions to this rule, right? If you stumble across a mom or her babies or her nest, she's going to defend her eggs or her babies. But that applies to pretty much all species, not just alligators. Okay? Another exception would be, for example, stumbling across an alligator with a recent kill. If he just took down a deer and you approach him, he might take you approaching as trying to take his food. But aside from that, for the most part, they really do just leave us alone. And now there's a simple reason as to why aggression levels are so different, and it's going to be lifestyle. See, alligators are solitary creatures. They do not hang out in groups, they don't hang out in packs. They spend the majority of their lives by themselves. They hang out with mom for 10 to 12 months, they leave, and at that point, the only other time in their lives that they hang out with alligators is going to be for mating purposes. Aside from that, they spend the majority of their lives by themselves. Throughout their lives, they never really have to compete or fight for much. Crocs, on the other hand, are pack animals. They do tend to hang out in groups. Now, usually when we think of a pack animal, what animal do we think of?
Wolves.
A wolf pack, right? Where everyone works together for the same common good of the pack. If I kill a deer tonight, guess what? We're all having dinner. Everyone gets to eat. Everyone gets taken care of. Crocs are the complete opposite. They're more like hyenas in the sense that they do hang out together, but it's every man on its own. It's a free-for-all. So it goes from, hey guys, we got dinner, to hey guys, don't you dare look at my deer, it's mine. And what ends up happening, we were fighting for it. That means from the second crocs are born, all they know is they have to compete and fight for everything just to survive. So that makes them a lot more aggressive than the alligators. Now this that we just drove over to, if you notice, somewhat of an oval shape, like a little pool, this is what we call a gator hole. And apparently minus my alligator, he must have stepped out to a local Starbucks. But just to verify if he's home, would you mind dropping a foot in the water for me really quick?
No, thank you.
Now, These holes are essential to the ecosystem out here. These are actually created by the alligators. So these guys use their mouths as a shovel. They dig everything up and they spit it out, creating those little patches of land. So while out here, it's only a foot deep. In the center of this, it can be 5 to 8 feet deep. Right? Now I dig out these holes mainly for two reasons. Number one, to have water during our drought seasons. See, here we do not have tides, so water levels do not fluctuate on a daily basis. Here we have rainy season and dry. During our rainy, we do have water in abundance, but during our dry, it can get so dry out here some years you can literally drive a car on this. At that point, the gators will rely on holes like this to have water. Reason number two is, in a sense, they're creating a trap. So there are fish and turtles navigating through this. And what are they looking for? Deeper water. So they come across these holes and hang out in here, allowing the alligators to have a food source. Now during those drought seasons, everything that's in the area will scavenger to find holes just like this to be able to survive that month to month and a half of no water. At that point, the gators get themselves an all-you-can-eat buffet. Everything they can possibly need and want will be trapped right here waiting.
Right.
Now interestingly enough, these guys are going to add to this every single year. So slowly but surely, they grow these little patches of land. As this thing grows in size, birds will bring seeds that give us trees. Now, after thousands of years of them repeating this process, a little piece of land like this turns into an island like that, guys.
Really?
They create the landscape out here. Now, that is what we call a hardwood hammock. And we've actually found artifacts on those islands that tell us the Native Americans used to live on. Now, you can't imagine that it's too small to house a whole tribe, but it is just big enough to house a family or two. At which point, I think it's ideal, because notice how close your neighbors are.
Yeah, far enough away.
Now, where are you guys visiting us from?
Roswell.
New Mexico.
New Mexico. All right, cool. Welcome. Nice. That's first. I don't think I've ever taken someone.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I've had New Mexico, but Roswell, like the capital of the aliens, never.
Yeah. After all that dirt and desert, we thought we'd get the swampy stuff tour going on.
There you go. Now, you guys hanging out with us here in Miami or down in the Keys?
We're heading down to the Keys.
All right, cool. You guys starting off here in Miami a couple days or just straight?
No, we started up Tallahassee, Pensacola. We're just working our way down.
Nice. And pit stops along the way?
Yep. Yes.
Any parks or just like RV parks and stuff?
No, hotels. And then we just been doing things like we went to Gatorland. We zipped over the Gators. We went to Pensacola, the Naval Air Museum.
Nice. Sweet, guys. Yeah. Sweet. Since my gator's not here, I'm going to go and take us for a little ride, see if we can find us an alligator that is home, okay?
Okay.
If by the end of the tour I do not find us an alligator, you guys are going to paper, rock, scissors, and whoever loses is going for a swim, okay?
That'll be him.
Then you better find a gator. I was just going to say, since we're both filming the same thing, when this battery goes, then we'll just crank that guy up and merge them together.
Okay.
Because it's going to be kind of hard, I think, in this to change batteries while it's going.
we'll look in here. Check this out. See him going in?
Yes.
He's right there.
There we go. All right, cool. No paper, rock, scissors.
He's a baby.
Hey, look at this. Whoa, shit! He's on your head. Ah! What the hell?
There you go. Now it's on my head.
Okay. He's going for a ride. He's still on his head. Coming right at us.
Oh. Ah.
Holy shit.
He's on a mission.
Holy crap.
Go ahead and crank that up, just in case.
Smokes. Oh my gosh.
Yuck.
He's on a mission.
We just stopped right behind us. Back here, guys.
Oh, there he is right there.
He's waiting for lunch.
Oh, he's checking out the menu.
He's coming. around the other side. Yep. There he comes.
He's coming up close and personal.
Yeah.
Truly majestic creatures, guys. Pretty much living dinosaurs.
That's no lie.
We do have fossils that predate alligators back to 8.5 million years. Now, if you think that 8.5 million years is not any significant evolutionary change, that means they kind of figured something out. Now, these guys do have 80 teeth, 40 on the top and 40 on the bottom. Now, the interesting thing about their teeth is that only half of it is solid. The other half is hollow. Reason being is in the hollow portion of that tooth, they have another one sitting in it. So if he was to take a bite out of a turtle and lose a tooth on that shell, he has another one to replace it. Now they do continue to regenerate teeth their entire lives. So we estimate that alligators go anywhere between 3,000 to 5,000 teeth in a lifetime. Talk about a great dental plan.
Yeah. Crazy.
Now, alligators have the third strongest bite on the planet. They bite at around 3,200 pounds of pressure. And just to put that into perspective, we as humans bite at around 200 pounds of pressure. A pit bull bite right around 500, while a lion bites just over 950. There are only two animals on this planet that bite stronger than the alligator. You guys want to take a wild guess what they are?
Croc.
Croc is number two, 3,700 pounds of pressure. What's number one?
Hippo.
Number five, 1,850.
I don't know.
I'll give you a hint, it's in the ocean.
Oh, shark.
Great white. Great white, so number one, the great white at 4,000 pounds of pressure.
Damn, man, he doesn't.
You expect to get that close to an alligator today?
No, I did not.
There's only one way to get closer.
Nope. I could. Holy cow. Whew, it's getting warm. I think I'm gonna put a little bit of sunblock on here before I start frying. Uh-oh.
Look at that, he's got that branch in his mouth.
He's got something in his mouth.
Yeah.
If he doesn't want to spit it out, it's not just that tree branch. He's probably got a turtle or something.
Oh, gotcha.
That's why he's holding onto that branch. He knows that if he opens his mouth, he could probably lose whatever's in there. Or maybe he was flossing and he needs your help to get it out of his mouth.
Like, I'm not sharing.
Who did? Look at him.
He's about to do it. He's called the bellow.
Oh, we got it.
So you heard it in the far?
Yeah.
He was responding.
Oh.
Nice little treat, y'all. The other guy's still going. Let me see if I can turn this around so we can get a better view. Oh, look, there's another gator right in front of us.
Pushing and let go. And then aim right over the top so you're just kind of pointing at it.
There it goes. Thank you.
big boy.
Oh yeah, looking about probably 9 foot.
Is that more like a mating call or?
Mm-hmm. If you notice, that actually sounds like it's getting closer. Back there doing it.
And here's this guy coming.
Jeez.
They're gonna have a party. And who said they don't have any fun?
Let's go check out this little one.
He's going down.
Hey, he'll resurface.
Oh, yeah, I know.
I know he wants to act shy.
Yeah. Yeah, hopefully that makes a good video.
baby alligator swimming over there. Oh, so cute. Where'd you come from, buddy? Let me try to turn this around before he disappears.
I missed it.
See if he's still there. Just all good, guys. Just got back into the grass back there. You can see him, he's working his way into the grass.
Yeah, I missed that one.
Yeah, he's right back in there. He went in there. I see his little head poking, but he's still moving into the grass. Yeah, he's back. That was a freshly hatched baby. Talking about weeks, maybe. Not big. And those little guys are so hard to see because when they're born, they're only 6 inches.
Yeah.
Right? And then they hide in there because at that size, everything eats them.
Right.
At that size, since everything eats them, they hide in the tall grass and brush so they can camouflage. So seeing that little guy, he was literally like right here in the middle. And he was swimming back towards the grass when we were going. It's a little odd. Usually they're not that brave. Let's keep our eyes open, because if there's one...
There's more.
There's more. Thank you.
bottom, right in between the twigs there.
Oh, yeah. Right there. He's running this way.
Hi, Blue.
You see him?
There you are.
No.
More to your right.
Oh, I see him now.
Now, down here, this is who I was calling. We've got the most colorful bird native to the state of Florida.
This one?
Nope.
No. That's up.
Down.
Down?
Right,
down.
Right there.
You got him.
And what is that?
Purple Gallinule.
Purple?
Gallinule. That is the most colorful bird native to the state of Florida. Second only to the peacock, which is not native to Florida.
Aren't you pretty? Can I take you home with me?
Absolutely majestic bird.
Can I take you home with me? You want to come along for the ride?
Thank you.
our Everglades Airboat Expeditions tour of the Everglades in southern Florida. Hope you like that adventure, and hopefully we'll see you on the next one. Say goodnight, Gracie.
Goodnight, Gracie.
Give the V, and that's all, folks.